Morning, my colleagues. We have a quorum at the appointed time for the panel security meeting and policy briefing. Please sit at your appointed seat. Would you like to speak? Please press your button. Confirmation of the minutes of previous meeting. The minutes of the meeting of 11th of October 2018 have been sent on 19th of October. We hadn't received any proposed amendments so far, so do we approve, endorse the amendments? Thank you. Two, information papers issued since the last meeting. We received a letter from James Cho, Alok, Hon Michael TIEN, Elizabeth QUAT, and hope that they can add items of their concern in the list of discussion items. And they have been added in the list of outstanding items for discussion. The Secretary would like to remind members there's a paper issued by the Hong Kong Police Force on the administration information paper on proposals to revise the fees for services. As of now, we haven't received any request for members to hold a debate on the paper. Date of next meeting and item for discussion. Like I said, the topics cited by members have been included, and we have met with the Secretary for Security on 24th of October to discuss the work plan for the year ahead. And the December meeting is set on 4th of December, Tuesday, on 2:30. And on that day, we will have the report of the study on matters raised in the annual report 2017 of the Chief Executive by the Commissioner on Interception of Communications and Surveillance, and the construction immigration headquarters in TKO, and as well as the proposed amendments to the first schedule to the Dangerous Drugs Ordinance. These three. And item four. And for those who would like to speak, please press the button now. And when we have invite the Security Bureau reps into the room, and today we have Mr. John Lee, Secretary for Security, Mr. Sonny Al, Undersecretary, Permanent Secretary for Security, Ms. Marion Lai, as well as Undersecretary, Ms. Sonny Al, as well as Mimi Lee, Vic Yao, Vicky Wong, and Mandy Chan, as well as Mr. Lau Wai Ming, Administrative Assistant to the Secretary. And we shall start out with Mr. John Lee, Security Secretary, to conduct a briefing on the CE policy address. And his speech will be distributed to members afterwards. And let me read out the order of speaking. Since we have quite a few items today, Mr. Holden Chow, Yu Si Wing, Elizabeth Quat, Chen Chen Ying, Sarah Lee, Pun Siu Ping, Siu Ka Chun, Kong Hoi Ye, and Priscilla Leung. You'd like to speak, please press the button now. I will draw the line later. You can begin it once you're ready. Thank you, Chairman. Today I will brief the panel on the SB initiatives 2018 policy address, which include new and ongoing initiatives. There are five new initiatives, while the ongoing ones I will report on two concisely. Of the new initiatives, the first one will be application innovation and technology enhanced to law enforcement capabilities. The Security Bureau will propel the Discipline Services Department and through the four-pronged strategy of application, R&D, analysis, and fortification to strengthen their law enforcement capabilities. And for example, the CST will include the smart elements in prisons and conduct tests in specific areas of some institutions using such as video analytics to modernize correctional facilities. and enhancing the efficiency of prison management and level security. And then CAG has picked a progressive approach on how to apply artificial intelligence and big data analysis to enhance enforcement capabilities and clearance efficiencies to assist in detection of contrabands. The immigration plans to implement the enhancement of the computer forensics examinations to enhance effective law enforcement. And they're also, we introduced the next generation application on investigation easy system to enhance core immigration services, including visa application, birth, death, marriage registrations, right abroad applications, assistance requests from Hong Kong residents in distress outside Hong Kong, and enforcement cases related investigation, detention, assessment, removal, etc. And also, HKPF will enhance the technology support for handling digital evidence, as well as studying the industry standard for security loopholes of smart devices, with a view to reconstructing the digital crime scene. The police will further enhance network security to help the ensuring the reliability information system and critical infrastructure, and for further upgrade its defense of cybersecurity to strengthen protection infrastructure. And the Fire Service Department plan to make use of big data analysis for information on fire incidents, fire equipment, service equipment in buildings and related inspections, with a view to enhancing fire safety strategies. Another new initiative was the implementation of the Animal Watcher Scheme. The police are committed to tackling crimes in relation to cruelty animals. And since April this year, in 22 police districts, we have set up a dedicated investigation teams. With the new financial year, the police will implement the Animal Watcher Scheme. And with a view to on four directions of education, publicity, investigation, intelligence gathering to consolidate the strength of animal lovers at a community level and raising public awareness on prevention of cruelty to animals and encouraging the public to report in a timely manner. And police will also coordinate and deepen the mutual understanding and partnership among different stakeholders, including relevant government departments, animal welfare organizations, and animal lovers. And thirdly, we shall amend the immigration ordinance. And we commenced a comprehensive review of the strategy of handling non-refoulement claims in early 2016. And so far, we've shown positive results. The number of non-ethnic Chinese illegal immigrants and non-refoulement claims had dropped significantly by 80%. And the number of named claims pending screening by immigration has also dropped 80% from the peak. The next step, the TCAB will accelerate the handling appeals, and as well to enhance the efficiency in handling firm claims. And the Security Bureau will move the amendments in early next year in order to increase the overall efficiency, and as well as would deter any delay in screening. And for company traffic in persons, in March 2018, a high-level interbureau departmental steering committee chaired by the Chief Secretary for Administration was established, and also promulgated the action plan to tackle trafficking in persons and to enhance protection of foreign domestic helpers, which present multifaceted measures that are comprehensive, strategic, and targeted. And so I hope that we can make departments work together to target the TIP issue as well as to achieve positive results in protection of FDH. The fifth will be the launch of the territory-wide identity card replacement exercise. And since the 26th of last month, in the five existing registration person office, the Immigration Department can issuing the new smart ID cards. And then also begin the replacement. And this replacement exercise, the Immigration Department, and for those persons with disabilities and the elderly, will provide on-site identity card replacement service and allow and those who in turn waiting for the identity cards to bring along persons age 65 in the same trip. And the public can also register the replacement advocate appointment and fill in the forms online. We set up self-service kiosk and self-service replacement kiosk. For ongoing initiatives, there are two on Safe City. In April, we've set up an interdepartmental counterterrorism unit, ICTU. Even though the Hong Kong terrorism attack risk is rather medium, there's no specific intelligence hinting the risk of terrorist attack. However, we shall be prepared as always. And the ICTU allowed the six discipline services using a common platform to enhance the collation, coordination, and public education. Another aspect will be enhancing the building safety of old buildings. And the legislation on the relevant matter had conducted public consultation on August to October. The results have shown that the stakeholders have agreed with the legislative proposal. We shall submit a bill to LegCo, and hopefully these amendments will be passed within this legislative year. And we'll also have this 2 billion fire safety improvement work subsidy scheme that will launch in July 2018 to subsidize owner of old composite buildings to undertake the fire safety improvement works. And this scheme the deadline was on Wednesday. We're now scrutinizing the details so that the application will be approved as soon as possible. That's the end of my briefing. I'll be happy to answer members' questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Lee. Mr. Holden Chow, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I have several questions. First, concerning the main part of the CNE department. Now, the trade description ordinance is dealing with quite a number of cases, and there is a strong demand for more manpower. I filed a question last year. As far as I know, in the past 3 years, there has been no enhancement in the strength of the CNE department in enforcing trade description ordinance. In view of such a strong demand for handling the cases, I just want to know whether there will be any enhancement in the manpower of the CNE department. Earlier on, I reported together with some of the victims to the CNE department on malpractice of some fitness centers. And it was also reported that arrests were made by the CNE department. And I've seen that the CNE department has been effective. I'd like to thank them. Since they are doing a good job, they should be provided with more resources because there's a great demand for law enforcement under the trade description ordinance. Another question is about combating trafficking in persons. There is an action plan, and that has displayed your commitment to this. Can you explain to us the manpower for the action plan? And if you are to strengthen your efforts on combating TIP, can you ensure that there will be adequate manpower to do that? And the third question is about the replacement of ID cards. In Para 11, to assist the elderly in replacing their ID cards, any person in changing their ID cards can bring along an elderly person with them so that they can change their ID cards together. But how many can one person bring? How many elderly person can one person bring? And is there a need to prove the relationship if the claim is about a relative? There's also, or as long as a young person can bring along a 65-year-old or more, a person 65-year-old or more, then that would be okay. Now, for an elderly who is 65 or above, he has time on that day. He can he just approach the replacement center on any day without a young person bringing him or her along. Say, for example, I have time today, so can I go to change my ID if I'm 65 or above? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chow. I think the first two questions are about manpower. In combating crimes in respect of false trade descriptions, I agree that there are many reports that they have to handle. That's within the policy portfolio of the CEED. But for drugs, that's within the portfolio of the SP. Your view will be reported to the Bureau. Our policy, apart from enhancing manpower, also attach importance to the efficient deployment of resources by the heads of departments. The proposal to make use of technology is to achieve the same target. Because of time constraint, I cannot speak too much on that, but they are already making use of technology. Say, for example, concerning screening, they make it more effective, they save more time in that, and they also target at cases which have higher chance of success in prosecution because of better evidence. I'd like to remind members that because of time constraint, if you want to ask questions, please be concise, and I cannot allow cause overrun by the officials too much. Next, Mr. Yu Siwing. The first question is on beating drugs. In October, Canada has started legalizing marijuana. So people can buy marijuana or products containing marijuana in Canada. Now there is a lot of traffic between Hong Kong and Canada. We have citizens visiting Canada, and sometimes they may unknowingly bring in products containing marijuana. Is there any way to prevent visitors from inadvertently breaching the law? The second question is anti-terrorist measures or counter-terrorism measures. Now, we are on the medium alert level, and we have new infrastructure such as the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge, and also the express rail, and also the Liantang Heng Yuan Wai crossing. Now, in comparison with the past, with the new infrastructure, what new measures will be made to prevent untoward incidents and to prevent the terrorists from taking any chances? Well, with regard to beating drugs, I'll ask the Narcotics Commissioner to answer. As for counterterrorism, this is our concern. The two important infrastructure facilities are equipped with a number of measures to reduce risk. Now, we have a team on critical infrastructure, and they deal with different kinds of security risk, and they implement various measures. The two major infrastructures are subject to some of our requirements in terms of security equipment and facilities, and also day-to-day monitoring. We also have established an intelligence network with the mainland, and there is a day-to-day coordination mechanism. Now, there is the bridge authority of the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge, and the authority has also designated liaison persons arrangements, and there is also a liaison mechanism for dealing with suspected criminals. And there are also drills. Because of time constraint, I'll stop here. I'll ask the Narcotics Commissioner to speak on marijuana. how we prevent people from inadvertently breaching the law. Yes, Ms. Chen. Yes, Mr. Chen is right that marijuana is allowed to be used for leisure in Canada. Now, there is an age limit. That's for those age 18 or above, which is health based, but that's allowed. But as for products containing marijuana, they are not lawful at present. So if you buy some products, you have to make sure that whether the product is lawful in that place. As for products bringing with marijuana being brought into Hong Kong, that may be in breach of the Dangerous Drugs Ordinance. We are responsible, the responsible authority, and we are working with the CNE department to draft a reminder to remind people that after they have been to the overseas countries, they have to pay attention that they will not bring products with marijuana content into Hong Kong. Ms. Elizabeth Quat. First, I'd like to welcome the administration in making use of technology to enhance law enforcement. I'm glad to see that the police will strengthen its efforts in protecting animals. As for dishonest access to a computer, the administration has suspended the prosecution. So what is the situation about dealing with this unlawful filming or video taking? I hope you will take the initiative to deal with that. We are waiting for many years for the LRC to review the law. I think there is a need to deal with this sneak filming. And I also want to know the timetable for the video recording of the police when they are on patrol. And I think the recent tragedy is an example which requires the early implementation of that. The Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Ms. Quat, for the question. Because the case is now under appeal, now, we have issued an instruction to the DOJ in respect of the cases which should be dealt with while and which should be held in abeyance waiting for the judgment of the court. Now, say for breaching a public system or loitering, these cases can be dealt with. As for sneak filming, during the appeal, it doesn't mean that we cannot initiate the investigation. As for the charge, it really depends on the outcome of the court decision. That's for the first question. I agree. On the second question, I agree that we should study the law as to how to make improvements to that. The LRC has proposed to propose certain arrangements, but we must not allow any vacuum in the law. But we have to understand whether by legislating we can deal with all situations. We therefore have to be very careful in using our resources. Now we have to keep an eye on the decision of the court, and we also need to review the law and how to improve upon that.
And thirdly, using body cameras to dealing with confrontations, and we had a report to this panel twice, and the police are proactively procuring this body-worn cameras, and a new generation of an intercom system that could apply this function. And the police commissioner had reported this panel that agreed that the body worn camera's effectiveness and hope that when the police officer on their duties, they can assist in their work and as well to obtain evidence to assist future prosecution and sentencing. And how about the question on the insulting public officials? Would you conduct a legal study on that? We know there is such a request. We have heard different views on that. And we are looking at the overseas approaches. And we also need to consider the legal perspective in the provisions. So we are still keeping an open mind that Mr. Chen Chenying. So I'm very much support the discipline service like Dr. Elizabeth Quat to using new technology to combat crime. I have three questions. And first, and on the smart prison, using video analytics to enhance the level of security. So can you elaborate on that? And especially some may involve individual particulars. So how do you strike a balance between security and privacy? And second, on R&D. And with respect to R&D, the HKPF plan to enhance the support for computer forensic examinations and also to reconstructing digital crime scene and enhance support for handling digital evidence. Because the technology crime bureau is very short on manpower, mainly handle internet security and online crime. So which unit will be responsible? And in the long run, this the R&D units are independent of the issues. Will there be a dedicated R&D unit to conduct R&D for all discipline services instead of having one department each discipline services? And in March, the Norton, the network security company, and claims that in Hong Kong there are over 2 million affected by online crimes, which is 43% of adult netizens, and about losing 1.234 billion US. Would you consider cooperating with network security specialists? For example, the government offering funding to purchase antivirus for free downloading by the public, so that the criminals cannot exploit the internet for their own gains. And for the smart prisons, the Correction Service Department, and in order to protect, maintain a discipline and a safety in prisons, in past cases and overseas experience, if there were fighting in the canteen, the scene might be quite different as an ordinary day. Well, maybe the image may congregate in a certain area. So we'll conduct an image analysis to input a lot of data into the system so as to see where there's some kind of activities which may deviate from the normal. Of course, we'll have the experts to conduct analysis through the system so that we can deploy more manpower. If we notice anything unusual, then we can immediately dispatch or to intervene so as to prevent fighting. And the hospital and the correction institutions will also have the smart bracelet. And when, let's say, the medical profession had a bracelet, suggestions that had a reminder that there will be a tendency to self-destruct, or maybe he have a heart condition, so maybe asking for digital bracelet so as to check if the pulse is normal. So hopefully that will lead to better management and safety. And when we come to the research development of different technologies to assist online work, whether for digital forensics, computer forensics, and other areas, there's no single way of doing it. There's their own R&D teams, and if necessary, they will contract out to outside experts for assistance. And the Information Technology Bureau will work with us as well. We also have different schemes of working with startups where we can collaborate. So for R&D, we keep an open mind to it. Well, my time is up, Ms. Charlie Lee. So it is not internet age, so like other members, I would like to acknowledge the government's effort to need to catch up with using INT to enhance their enforcement capabilities. There's no mention in the document on how to crack down the online scams. I especially care about this as a woman. So the online romance scams, you claim there are 60 people being conned and deceived of 44 million. Well, in the future, the thief will not hold up, brandish a knife for robbery. They probably just organize scams. So as the police and the security bureau, internal structure and manpower and strategy, even the legislation should move in pace with the times. I would like to hear from police on their strategy. So, police used to conduct a lot of undercover operations for its online romance scams, managed to get swindle a lot of money. So would you consider going undercover, especially those where money and romance is concerned? I wonder how the police strategy for that. And second, my question is on the smart ID replacement scheme. Well, now that this exercise had begun, the public began to show more concern. So now that we're in a tech age, well, the smartest part of the ID, they would use it to gone through immigration. So after replacing my ID card, so what are the enhancements, just to let the public know, Secretary? For online scams, well, there are two common categories. One of them is telephone scams, well, online romance or through telephone. I would like to thank the LegCo in allowing the police to set up the network security and tech crime bureau, and after 3 years, had created a superintendent position. Like Ms. Lee said, in terms of formulating a strategy and international cooperation, that is the duty of the superintendent. And since we have this post, we managed to deliver results. And recently, we were working with overseas law enforcement agencies to crack down on online scammers, and working with different countries and jurisdictions, making arrests, and the involving a quite colossal amount of money. Well, we talk about millions and tens of millions here. So we always want to increase manpower. However, to crack down on online scams, would you consider undercover? Well, I'm not going to mention how we're doing it. If I tell you how, well, the syndicates maybe get a clue. So we'll resort to every option necessary. The technology and knowledge is more important when it comes to tech crimes and overseas cooperation as well. And the example I said, just want to make the point that from the Interpol level, Hong Kong police have done a great job. And a lot of multinational arrest in which the Hong Kong police play a proactive role by providing intelligence or coordination or case sharing and liaising with different units. We have this G8 liaison point mechanism, and the and we can communicate 24/7. Do any additional smart function in the smart ID? We have to ensure security, and the IDs are actually smart. And biopassing immigration, the smart technology will aim to get through the immigration gates quicker and safer. If the public can choose to include some service in the ID, for example, library lending card, as well as the medical records. The public are free to opt in. We spent about 45 minutes. Do any other members would like to speak, please press the button now. Otherwise, I shall draw the line and stop accepting questions. Mr. Pun Xiuping. Just now, the Secretary mentioned that of the new initiatives on security, the one of which will be applying INT to enhance law enforcement capabilities. I very much welcome and support this. In fact, the CNSD have high turnover rates, and it plan to introduce smart elements in prisons. In some institutions, they will conduct trial testing to enhance the efficiency and security level. My question is, now that you're so many disciplined and serve forces under your bureau, they plan to apply INT to, do you have to estimate how much resource will be involved, and how much would the manpower shortage situation improve? And for the smart ID replacement exercise, and you mentioned that you will provide an on-site identity card replacement service for the elderly and the PWD. And now that the replacement has begun, do you have a timetable to conduct this on-site replacement service? And when will this on-site service be concluded? And it also mentioned in the paper, and enhancing the self-help capabilities and survival skills of the public in case of emergencies. And you know that there are new elements in the public education by the FSD and ambulance services. And what's the progress and how effective with that? Do we have less people abusing the ambulance services? Thank you, Mr. Poon. When applying technology to help the enforcement agencies, our resource estimate is that at this stage would allow department to resort to different means, for example, using their own resources. And that include the ITB already have this resource plan, a scheme which if you can apply, and if necessary, they can work with the INT companies. Then we allow different departments to adopt various means to achieve that. So at this stage, we don't really have a formal figure, and development is still unfolding, we need a substantial funding that we will grant it. And under ITB, there are a lot of resources available to different departments to apply and to utilize. And
we are working on it. As for the replacement details of replacement of ID cards, I'd ask the Ms. Chen to explain. Ms. Wong to explain. Thank you, Mr. Poon, for the question. As for the replacement of smart ID, on the 26th, the five registration office will provide the replacement. And the full replacement scheme will be launched at the end of the year. As for the homes for the elderly, homes for the disabled, which are licensed. There are about 1,000 of them, and we expect that about 80,000 people will be benefited by this on-site scheme. In fact, the Director of Immigration has contacted these institutions, and they welcome the arrangement, and they are working out the details. It's expected that they will launch the on-site service in the second quarter of next year. Mr. Xiu, Chairman, I will speak on paragraph 8 and 9 in respect of amending the immigration ordinance. Concerning the NCII, the number has substantially increased. The number of cases waiting screening has been reduced substantially by 80%. The target is to reduce claimant cases. When did you start having this target? And I'm worried that in order to achieve these targets, you have failed to discharge your responsibility in respect of upholding human rights. How can you safeguard people from wrongly being wrongly removed? And I'm also concerned that those successful cases are very few. And there is an impression in the community that most of the cases are abuses. But the Immigration Department, in rejecting the claims, adopt the same reasons. They just copy the reasons for rejection. But each case have different circumstances. So do the officers have been fully trained and equipped with suitable knowledge? People have the misunderstanding that there are only refugees in Syria because of war, but because in South Asia there are many people suffering from torture and also other persecutions because of religion, social condition, and so on and so forth. In paragraph 9, the administration says that a full review will be conducted and reference will be made to overseas countries in terms in respect of the arrangements and the law. I want to ask the Bureau from which country do the Security Bureau learn in respect of their experience and their systems? Mr. Seal, Mr. Chairman, we are not under the UN Convention on Refugees. When people come in Hong Kong illegally, since they have no right of abode in Hong Kong, we have to repatriate them to their countries of origin. And before repatriation, they can lodge a non-refoulement claim, and they will have to give their reasons. We will have to consider whether their claims can be established or not. If not, then they will be repatriated. I want to tell Mr. Xiu and the community that the Refugee Convention is not applicable to Hong Kong or has yet to be applicable to Hong Kong. We assess the risk of the claimants and we conduct an assessment, and there is an appeal mechanism to make sure that the claims are fairly and properly dealt with. As for the cases that have been screened, the success rate is 0.8%, less than 1%, that is. I agree that some did have justifiable reasons and therefore they are allowed to stay, but more than 99% of them are not substantiated. And we have high standards of fairness. That is the standard handed down by the court. Mr. Xiu, after the Immigration Department has made a decision, there is an appeal mechanism, and there is also a JR mechanism. The success rate is very low as well. More than 99% of the claimants were unsuccessful, and after the appeal, the number of success is also very low. We have to make sure that Hong Kong is not a place where the IIs can find jobs. My final question is, what are the relevant laws and systems that the SB learns from? Well, the example is some countries in the European Union, Australia, New Zealand, Canada. Chairman, I'm also Ms. Yong. Yes, I'm dealing with non-refoulement claim cases. I also handle such cases, and I have the so-called cooperation with the Immigration Department. We want to help the claimants so that if they their stay is justified or they have justified reasons, they can stay. And if not, then we hope that they will go to back to their place of origin or to other places. Starting from 2016, when the administration launched this handling of non-refoulement claims policy, the number of cases has substantially dropped, in particular those coming from India. I appreciate the efforts of the Immigration Department and Police. The number of claimants have declined. But my concern is that those who are given a permit to wait for the outcome of the screening, the number has increased. I think more than 1,500, and the crime rates among them are high. The administration will make use of technology to enhance security. I want to ask whether in places where there are many claimants, more technology facilities should be added to reduce the number of crimes. The Secretary, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Yong, with regard to using technology to help a law enforcement agency. This is our policy. That's a good suggestion. I ask the police to look into that. As for whether there can be some development in R&D, I'll let them do the job. As for those who are giving a permit to wait for the outcome, and therefore they can stay for a while in Hong Kong, I agree with Ms. Yong that there are about 1,000 or so people in 2016, about 1,500. Under the OSCB, there is a dedicated team to deal with the risks that may be created by NECIIs and also the claimants. We will step up, they have stepped up intelligence gathering, they pay special attention to black spots, they also have targeted measures, say for example, more patrolling. They will visit more often the places when there are many claimants, and they will also conduct some questioning and search. The PCRO also pay attention to the effects that may be caused by the claimants. Now, that may not be law and order, that may be, say, some kind of obstruction, or some people are concerned that they will be affected because of the claimants. Now, the police will share intelligence among their various districts and formations by making use of data and analysis. Their work is more focused, and they also will respond to the advice of the districts. Ms. Priscilla Leung, first, I welcome to see that the policy address makes reference to two items. First, the Animal Watch scheme, I hope the administration will work with the university that has such a department so that young students can participate. I teach in the CTU, but I'm not teaching at the vet school, but the department next door covers that discipline. I also welcome the enhancement of fire installations. The administration will provide a 2 billion subsidy from the motion debate to the policy address. I've been asking for that, and I hope more can be added to the subsidy. The third is this. In fact, there are two items. Whether legislation will be made for humiliating the police, I think the Secretary has responded by saying that he is studying that. Now, we have not further promote the private members bill because there is a kind of a reduction in the sentiment, and therefore we have put it on hold. But if there is further searches, then we may speed up the push. Now the parties concerned have launched appeals. Now, there are police officers who are dedicated to enforcing the law. They follow the instructions they learn from the training school. But because of some unexpected events, there is a problem with them, and they are now being prosecuted. It's not, he made a move, and then the other party resisted the arrest, and then there was a situation. I think that is a really setback to police morale, and the prosecution or the charge is rather serious. Now, how can you make sure that the police officers who have learnt and followed instructions at training school, and because of other situations, there was an incident and there was an injury or even death? How can you make sure that the police are protected when they are discharging their duties? Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Leung, for paying her attention to the various aspects of the work under the Security Bureau. We've heard various comments in respect of Animal Watches scheme and also support under CAP 572, and they are all done after we've heard views from the community. As for the offense of humiliating the police, as said by Ms. Leung, we have adopted an open mind. We study how overseas countries deal with that. I agree that if we have other measures to improve the situation, we should actively pursue that. So in respect of the body-worn camera, it has been quite successful. With 80% of the conflicts, after the body-worn camera is was switched on, the situation de-escalated. So we will pursue this. As for the incident mentioned by Ms. Leung, that's tragic. Or rather, this is unfortunate. This is unfortunate, I beg pardon. There is a heavy legal responsibility in enforcing the law. How can the police enforce the law without causing serious consequences? That's something that they need to consider. And suggestions are now being considered so that in enforcing the law, police officers can achieve the objective without worrying what they have done will lead to legal consequences. Now they can serve the public in a reasonable manner. Oh, we will look into that, Mr. James Toh.
I try to be closer to the microphone. First, I would like to follow on my colleague's question. When the place of commissioner and the security bureau described as unfortunate, so we have to be careful with the choice of words, because now the court had ruled that this was killed unlawfully. That's members of the public met tragedy. It was illegally killed by the law enforcement officer. That's ruled by the court, not criminal. But yet, that's yet to be decided. You can't give the impression this death of natural causes. This is being killed unlawfully. So, using technology for law enforcement, that's the trend to stay, whilst it has permeated every corner of our life. At the same time, just like the coroner court suggestion that the police vehicle is the first point of arrest. When you arrive at the police station, then that you'll be inspect for injuries or whether you have complaints. When you're at a police vehicle, there are a lot of complaints. So the police vehicle, objectively, is just like the entrance of the police station requires CCTVs to ensure the law is fairly enforced. That instead of having the police officer to decide when to turn on their body worn cameras. And the online scam I've quite a few experienced over a decade ago. And during the budget debate and the policy address have appealing to the, I've been appealing that because the that will be the way to make money. They will stop using knife to rob a bank and so on. Well, see how much money the hackers made from hacking their banking websites. So in order to protect the public, while some members of the public are not so sophisticated or well-equipped, so the government had a had great responsibility. I want to give the government some time to explain. So how can you target these so that friends and relatives of the victims can watch out for each other to prevent further scams. And for the scam raised by James Toe, I believe that we will report to this panel. And for the police and the information dissemination and the case handling, we have made various initiatives. And well, their modus operandi is ever changing. First, we had to make it public and know that there are always new tactic, and the police will made public in time with new tactics, and will. Well, there are two fronts: information determination, one where they are receiving, and giving out money, so we try to publicize them through various means, so that they could be aware all the time. That's our job. Well, maybe some people will be busy, or maybe not. They're not able to reach popular mass media, which I will try to reach the public through various means. If you have any suggestions to our information dissemination strategy, please provide them to us, because I hope that the public can protect themselves. What can police can do in terms of scams? On various occasions that we have had this. And 24-hour hotline on ADC, Anti-Deception Coordination Center, to listen to The report of the call include consultation and crime reporting and advisory, as well as ADCC will proactively intercept the flow of money. We are working with banks and the overseas enforcement agencies. We shall listen to every advice, and if Mr. To can point out which area we can do better, please let me know, because you just want to tackle the problem. Mr. Tony Chair, so building safety is very important, and the government have done a lot and offered some subsidy, for example, the mandatory window and building inspection, and now we have the lift inspections. I noticed it in the document, and for Paragraph 17 on the fire safety of industrial buildings. So there was public consultation that we just concluded. In this industrial buildings, there are fire safety equipment. They're very important. And yet, Chief Executive hoped that some of the industrial building can be used for residential purposes. Second point. There'll be more uses inside industrial buildings over time. So in terms of fire safety requirement, in industrial buildings, have you took that into account? Of course, you can set a very high threshold. However, that would may place obstacles in the conversion into transitional housing, which made the owners of this building lose interest. Now that we have an acute housing shortage, boosting land supply, the government is working on it. However, on the approving the development plans, the trade have complained and there insufficient manpower in processing applications. I see there's some recent improvements. I wonder if the Fire Service Commissioner, in terms of training, as well as to approval of building plans in FSD. Thank you, President and Mr. Chair. And our fire safety buildings ordinance, we need to consider the fire safety standard. We understand that this may add to the cost for the sector. However, since we talk about human lives here, we must definitely uphold some standards. But after setting some standards, then how we can apply it flexibly, that should be considered by different departments. And for CAP 572, even though we have the Fire Safety Improvement Work Subsidy Scheme, I believe that it works the same for industrial buildings. And without violating fire safety standards, how they could flexibly apply under 572, CAPS 572, the composite buildings, we have offered improvised measures. And for industrial buildings, the fire safety standards, we talk about their construction. For example, the sprinkler system, fire escaped. I believe these are the ones that we must uphold. And in our consultation, we noticed that the cost concern wasn't particularly evident. Or maybe we can liaise with Mr. Chair to find out where your concerns are. Another question on manpower. So the actual circumstances, how we deploy resources. Like I said, for each department, besides adding more manpower, they would try to use big data and technology. And FSD will be on it. For example, for fire safety inspection, they will computerize the process, and they will notice discover a pattern, so to conduct more frequent inspection. And for example, they would know the risk profile of the area, and would enhance the processing efficiency. That's why we hope to make use of technologies to boosting our processing efficiency. Dr. Cheng Chung Tai. If not that, Dr. Priscilla Liao mentioned the tragedy of the killed taxi driver. I hadn't planned to ask a question. And how do you mention that you can something you can learn in the police academy? Well, it was just simply a cafe dispute that would actually turn the driver's head 90 degrees as in some kind of enforcement. Well, I feel chilled down my spine listening to Dr. Liao. How can you just simply brush it up as a tragedy? Well, that's according to court decided that it was unlawful killing. Well, 21 years ago, it was about lawful killing, which was shocked hung society. So what was it really all about? How can you say that in this venue that you can learn it in a police academy? On this, I will raise an oral question on the enforcement guidelines of the police. Therefore, I will not argue with the secretary. While the public have made it on mind on this incident, and I believe that the truth is pretty clear. And that is the outcome of the court ruling. And now the FHB have committee consultation on the road safety ordinance, which conclude on September 30th, on proposing to adding cats and dogs when they're and on the handling when they're being hit on the road, whether they need to report to police and the relevant penalties. And the secretary mentioned that the police will set up the animal watchers scheme, and there will be a dedicated investigation team to deal with animal welfare related cases for the road safety amendments. And we do see the timetable as well at the coordination, and when the road safety amendment ordinance be enacted, and what can the front line do and let the public aware that there will be relevant penalties. Second question. And on the moneylenders ordinance, Mr. Horace Cheng, these 2 years have been following up on that. And this year, I received various cases. For example, let's say the advisor have the person particulars used by someone they don't know, and they would actually threatened with illegal debt collection activities. I actually need to call the money lending concern. However, no substance as for the money lender ordinance, whether there will be any potential for amendment and whether it is feasible. Well, thank you, President, Chairman. And for the road safety ordinance amendments, that's handled by the Food and Health Bureau. And the Animals Watcher Scheme mentioned in the policy address. This similar to a junior police call. The focus is on animal protection. Regardless of the amendments, the police will launch the scheme anyway. And of course, and if there are elements in the amendments that could facilitate the handling of animal being under abuse and under this scheme, that we can enhance the assistance and information dissemination and encourage more effective reporting, we'd have to decide, look at the actual provisions. As for the moneylender ordinance,
FSTB. It falls under the FSTB. Your view will be relayed to the Bureau. Thank you. Mr. Chen Qiqian. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, I want to follow up on the Immigration Amendment Ordinance. In the QT case, the Immigration Department lost the litigation, the immigration policy was changed. Apart from spouse, husband and wife, the qualified guarantors, same-sex civil wedding, same-sex wedding, hetero wedding, heterosexual wedding, civil wedding. These are the conditions for the definition application for coming to Hong Kong under the dependency dependent arrangement. Now, in the past, the homosexual partners cannot come to Hong Kong. Now, that is now possible. So is it is it a change in law or a change in your policy? It is based on the QT case and overseas talent came to work in Hong Kong because of the civil wedding, and the partner can also come to Hong Kong. Now, I want to know, a permanent resident of Hong Kong through lawful civil wedding have a partner. This is a kind of same-sex marriage. Under the new policy, can the partner get a dependent visa and come to stay in Hong Kong? And then another question is that in September, the administration has given a electrical brief in respect of same-sex wedding, same-sex civil relationship. Now they have same-sex marriage. They it is in quotation. Other people may not have any specific impression about it, but you have you put same-sex marriage in quotation. Whether same-sex civil wedding, heterosexual civil wedding, so on and so forth, apart from the there has been no change in policy. Why you need to put that in parentheses? Is that an appeal mechanism? Now, your working visa, if it is rejected, no explanation is not given. And not to say the dependent of one who come to work in Hong Kong. If no approval is given, there is no explanation. Is there any appeal mechanism? Thank you, Mr. Chen. Hong Kong does not recognize same-sex marriage. I think everybody knows. And Mr. Chen also knows that. We don't want to cause any misunderstanding or speculation, and we believe the expression is inappropriate, that cohabitation is, or that spouse relationship, you don't recognize that. Well, I've already answered your question. There is an appeal mechanism. If there is any decision under our immigration policy, if anybody is aggrieved and wants to appeal, there is a mechanism. And there is a procedure to deal with that. Those who are aggrieved can raise the appeal. My basic question is that Hong Kong PR has a spouse through civil wedding. Can the dependent obtain a visa under this policy? The question is very clear. With regard to our immigration policy in respect of the dependents, the conditions are very clear. Just yes or no, but the Secretary does not want to answer that directly and asked me to read the paper. Well, if you are not happy with his answer, I can't help, because that happens quite often. I think he's already got an answer. And he asked me, I just think that it's very clear. When he asks a question, he's already got the answer because we've set out all the conditions, all the terms and clauses in our paper. Mr. Ma Fung Kwok, I'm glad that the police will make use of technology to enhance his law enforcement capability. But I feel that the challenge is getting bigger, and they say the recent food fest, that is an incident, and also that is leakage of information of a big airline company, and also a payment system has to be stopped because of certain hacking. How can you catch up with new technology so as to help your enforcement? Say, a face recognition technology, big data, and the use of big data. How can you make sure that you are not falling behind? The culprits also are able to make use of high technology. So how can you be more advanced? Well, you have pointed out that we have to face the challenge. Well, I think it's a competition of technology in cyberspace. It is just a battle. The more capable will overcome. All law enforcement agencies have to face this. I require the law enforcement agencies not to dodge this reality. They have to recognize this reality. We have to come face up to and compete with those who commit crimes in cyberspace. There is a need to enhance our technology and knowledge. In Hong Kong, we should contact various experts and also people of the trade, and also, more importantly, we need to participate in international meetings. We try to know the overall trend in the world and how overseas law enforcement agencies and experts deal with the situation. Training is important. Under the Interpol, in the Asia-Pacific region, there is an expert group on technology crime, and we are a member, and in fact, the Hong Kong Police is the chairman. I don't know whether our colleague is still the chairman, but there is no information that the chairman's place has been taken over by somebody else. Hong Kong plays a role, a positive role, and we are also influential in this respect, and we can say our technology is at par with other authorities in the world. If we are allowed to provide training. In fact, the Hong Kong Police has been recognized by the Interpol to have training capacity. That is no the best, but we have to do better. And we have to, and I agree with Mr. Ma, and I asked my departments to do their best. The last member on the list is Ms. Au Nok Hin on this item. Good morning, Chairman. I have two groups of questions. First, on using technology to enforce the law. In the prisons, you will use video analysis to conduct your control. So will that extend to the police, to policing? Say, for example, you install more cameras for the ease of law enforcement. That involves privacy. Have you consulted the Privacy Commission on this? My concern is that the Chinese government has gone to the extreme. They have the network. They have 170 million cameras. They have facial recognition mechanisms, and they can even record the whereabouts of the persons and vehicles in the past week. And they have sensors, and they know who were you accompanying. If there is such a network of using cameras for policing, will you introduce such an extreme method, such an extreme approach? What is your second group? The Reuters said that the Security Bureau will have its political mission, but the police said that the security wing is responsible for protection of VIPs, counterterrorism, coordinating security work, and the security wing involves operational aspects which should not be disclosed. As for the ITCU, ICTU rather, can you explain the delineation of work between the ICTU and the security wing? Is there any duplication? Yes, thank you, Chairman. Thank you. Mr. Au, with regard to the use of technology outside Hong Kong for policing, he may not be referring to a single country or other places. In fact, many countries have done which can achieve the objectives and extend, as mentioned by Mr. Au. But this is something which we cannot speak on behalf of other governments. In terms of technology, we have to comply with the law in using technology. Now, that is the privacy ordinance, and we therefore have to comply with the restrictions of the privacy law. In certain areas, there are exemptions. Say, for example, prevention and detection of crimes. Information can be, personal information can be made use of. All law enforcement agencies will comply with the privacy ordinance. The police has to comply with the law in all it does. The ICTU. Concerning the ICTU, I think Mr. Au may recall that in the last legislative year, I reported to members the work of the ICTU. The ICTU does not take over the work of other forces. It only provides a platform for data analysis or intelligence, disclosure of information and training for six forces, so that there can be full cooperation and information and intelligence can be made use of, so that Hong Kong can still be one of the safest cities in the world. So you have consulted the Privacy Commissioner, have you? Haven't you? In various ways, in various aspects, we need to consult and or inform the commissioner, the Privacy Commissioner. As for established policies, the policies are clearly in line with the Personal Data Privacy Ordinance, and the law enforcement agencies also comply. We conclude our discussion on this item. We move on to item number five, which is the manpower proposal for the comprehensive review of strategy of handling non-refoulement claims. Other LegCo members invited to participate in the discussion. Please note that if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interests in respect of this item, please declare your interest. I ask Mr. Ao, the Undersecretary, to introduce a paper, and then I'll let members to ask questions.
And we also have the Deputy Director of the Immigration, Mr. Wang Chun-up, and Ms. Fung Wah, Assistant Director of Immigration, and Mr. Billy Wu, PAS for Security, and Ms. Maggie Wang, Deputy Secretary for Security 3. So the Undersecretary can start once you're ready. And if you'd like to speak, please press the button. The Security Bureau began in 2016 and on conducting a comprehensive review of the strategy on handling and reforming claims. And we have created two supplementary reports with the approval of the FC till the 31st of April 2019. And since the comprehensive review, we implement a raft of measures and achieve certain results. And the number of non-ethnic Chinese illegal immigrants and the number of non-reforming claimants had reduced by 80% from the peak. As of end of September, and those pending for screening their immigration, there are 1,374 and 80% drop. 1,743 claims, rather. Even though we achieved some progress, however, this shows challenges ahead. As for the end of September 2018, there is about 6,500 appeal lodged by claimants rejected by Immigration Department pending decision by the Torture Claims Appeal Board, TCAB. We expect that it will require 2 to 3 more years to complete the hearing and the backlog. To expedite the removal of rejected claimants, we also require take timely measures. And moreover, SB in the early next year, they would table a immigration amendment bill to enhance the screening procedures and to prevent any delay tactics. Besides the passage of the bill, the transition arrangements as well as the enhanced procedures will require a timely implementation. And the Immigration Department will need to handling appeals and screening procedures and handling the certain legal matters and the enforcement matters to provide support. And currently, the removal of claimants falls within the ambit of the enforcement division. To better coordinate the work, the Immigration Department that set up a new division and under the Removal Assessment and Litigation Branch, under the Assistant Director, Removal Assessment and Litigation, which is responsible for repatriating removees to ensure their early departure. So under SB, that the two supplementary posts are retained for 3 years till 22nd, 2022, 31st of March to provide a dedicated steer and supervision of the comprehensive review, and hope the members will support extending this disciplinary directorate post. Once obtaining the panel support, the SB will submit the funding application to the ESD. There are 8 members who would like to speak. Oh, we still have one more item, so I'll only allow 3 minutes each. Mr. Pun Xiuping. Even though the number of non-reforming claims have fell from the week, there's still a huge backlog. And the non-reforming claims had troubled Hong Kong for quite some time. And at the last month, there's a public hearing in LegCo, and the deputation has spoken that this claimant state in Hong Kong would pose serious law and order issues at community level. Therefore, I support this SB manpower proposal to shorten the screening time, expedite the removal of rejected claimants. And now you said there are 6,500 case appeals lodged with claimants, and now that we decided to extend the PAS for reviewed, it would take about 2 to 3 years. So, and every year there are only 2,000 cases to be cleared. Can you further expedite the cases? And how much time did each appeal take? And for the processing speed immigration, from 25 weeks to be shortened to 10 weeks. Second question, at this PAS, we also evaluate the effectiveness of existing legislation. And on the penalty on people smuggling syndicate is also one area for review. And how many prosecutions of syndicates, and what is the sentencing situation? Undersecretary, thank you for Mr. Poon's question, and thank Mr. Poon for the support for the manpower proposal and for the appeal progress. Very much depends on the resource available, and the number of TCAB from 28 members have been expanded to 99. And we have more members on board. We expedite the progress. We also need to look at the hardware, for example, the venue and conference rooms availability. In the beginning of next year, we plan to table the immigration amendment bill. And we also propose enhancement to the screening appeal procedure and enhancement if we get the electrical support. The number of appeals and the appeal procedure itself will be benefit. Let me speak of some numbers. Mr. Poon may still remember previously. We have table an immigration amendment bill, and we toughen up the penalty for people smuggling syndicates. From the previous sentencing, from 3 years of maximum sentencing to 14 years, all the fine from the max to $25,000 to $5 million. So that is the penalty for people smuggling. Next, Mr. Alokhin. So, Deputy Secretary, you plan to extend the post to 2022. We also consider amending the immigration amendment bills all to deal with the appeal procedures. I would support the streamlining of the procedures. And now, however, your proposed amendments will affect the right for equal hearing of the applicants. For example, shortening that the appeal period to 14 days. You might be familiar with the Canadian example. There are only about 12 to 20 pages of question with success rate of 70%. So we have 28 pages, 70 questions, success rate much, much lower. And the on-duty lawyers would need to draft an appeal within 14 days of immigration. That will be quite difficult. So that rather than reducing the day preparation days, suddenly we have a much less substantial sort of backlog, and he claimed that early next year able to clear the backlog. Shouldn't the amendment bill should also deal with the processing indicators so that the claimants would not have to wait indefinitely? And while dealing with the immigration ordinance and the appeal mechanism, or the said you have a surplus of manpower, could you do with the more genuine cases? I also mentioned about non-Chinese, ethnic Chinese illegal immigrants. You should talk about non-Chinese national illegal immigrants. So this Chinese and Chinese national, there are actually some difference. Undersecretary. While formulating the screening standards, we have reference from overseas practices and past experience. So we need to maintain a high standard of fairness. And when conducting a review, we'll continue to uphold this to ensure that every screening could meet the high standard of fairness as set by the court. In our comprehensive review, when we table the amendment bill, well, before that, we will definitely consult the relevant stakeholders, which including Hong Kong Lawyers Association and the Hong Kong Bar Association. I believe that we will be in line with global practice and the Canadian example cited by Mr. Ao, our proposal will be roughly in line with Canada. At least you should provide some template for the lawyers to fill in the form. Dr. Quat, I agree that these two posts should be extended. While to continue to steer or do the comprehensive review as well as expediting the processing backlog. And you mentioned the duties of the PAS, one of which would be to provide administer the pilot scheme on provision of public funded legal assistance for non-refoulement claimants. There's some of the law firms might be a suspect of encouraging the claimants to litigate to in order to get more billing. So do you consider how to prevent this from occurring or to investigate such potential abuses? And looking at the amount of public funded legal assistance for the 2017-18, we're talking about $143 million for 18-19 year, and $271 million. As we see more cases like this, this PFLA amount will continue to rise. These are taxpayers' money. Is there any way to prevent abuse? Undersecretary. And thank you, Dr. Quat's question, and thanks for your support for the extension of the two supernumerary posts. And for the pilot scheme for PFLA for non-refoulement claimants, this has been in place for a year. And this is a pilot scheme, so 1 year on, we'll shall conduct a review. And for this pilot scheme, there's some difference with the duty lawyer scheme, is that we provide a one-off funding to the lawyers who took part in handling these cases. If the more complicated cases or the one-off funding is not applicable, this case can be referred back to the duty lawyer scheme. I believe that these two programs are complementary. We can address some concerns, and we also need to ensure that there will be a smooth implementation and provide sufficient legal assistance to the non-refoulement claimants. And Chairman, when providing sufficient legal representation, would also prevent abuse or making money. Would you? Thanks for Dr. Quat Expert. That's also included in our review.
Dr. Fernando Chung. Chairman, I oppose this manpower proposal. As for those who are making claims and who are waiting for an appeal, the number has declined by 80%, which is substantial. I see no reason for keeping these posts. According to the Bureau, the non-refoulement strategy, or the handling strategy for non-refoulement claims is very successful, you stop them, they better not come because you prevent them from coming to Hong Kong. You drive them away as early as possible, and you also lock them up. So the whole policy is not to welcome them, and when they come, you give them a subsidy which they can't keep them survive. You just give them $1,500 for rent and $1,500 for food and half for children. And they cannot work in Hong Kong, so you can't survive in Hong Kong. The whole policy is negative and discriminatory. I heard from the secretary, they are worried that if the claimants are gathering in Hong Kong, living in the community, they will cause obstruction and they will cause the residents to worry about their security. Chairman, I know that you are supportive of the government's position and you adopt different ways to mock at us who adopt a more humane approach in handling the claimants. This has shown the narrow-mindedness of Hong Kong. This is not in line with the value standard of the world, and that's shameful to Hong Kong. And this policy continues, and the claimants will be detained for a longer time, and they will be more penalized. They will be penalized more heavily. It's good to penalize the traffickers, but these claimants, these people seeking asylum, should not be regarded as criminals. The present direction and approach is wrong. We should adopt a humane approach, and therefore I oppose the proposal. The Secretary, do you need to reply? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Chow. A brief reply is this. We have to extend these supernumerary posts. The reasons have been given in the paper. I hope that Mr. Chang can understand that the extension is to respond to the demand of the community and is in line with public interest. Ms. Priscilla Leung, Chairman, Hong Kong is generous and humane, and such generous legal aid service is first in the world. We don't want too many IIs. We don't want people to abuse the non-refoulement claim system. We don't want them to be stranded in Hong Kong. Therefore, we need to prevent the IIs from coming to Hong Kong and clear the case or clear the backlog. As for genuine claimants, they will be distinguished from those who abuse the system. So we don't want people to abuse the system. If those who are true amnesty seekers, they will come to Hong Kong because they're suffering. But for those who want to seek a job in Hong Kong, they will come. They come as IIs. They want to get a job. And if they are given adequate subsidy, they can make a good living in Hong Kong, then they will continue to come. I heard that the government is going to identify new detention centers. This is not a closed camp, but they're looking for new detention centers. The number has declined. Can the process be speeded up? I, of course, support the extension to posts. I hope the administration will respond. According to newspapers, you are identifying locations for new detention centers. Although they are not closed camps, you are not going to give them cash for food and for lodging. you will put them in detention centers and then screen and conduct screening. I thank Ms. Leung for the support. As for Ms. Leung's questions, my reply is as follows. We will adopt a lawful and practical ways. We consider resources and law and public safety. We consider all the practical ways, but we have to comply with the law. And if need be, we may make legal proposals too. How are you going to respond to the report in the newspaper, the Oriental Daily? You are looking for places to build new detention centers. We are considering that, but we have no definite plan yet. And if we have, we will come back to the council and report to the council and the panel. Members, I have 7 members in the list. We still have the briefing by the commissioner of the ICAC. So I'll draw a line there if there is no objection. After Mr. Ho, Junius Ho. Mr. Zheng Kuo-kwan, Chairman, I support the administration's proposal of extending the 2 supernumerary posts. Honestly speaking, in the past few years, the Bureau has achieved some success. Say the number of backlog has declined substantially. The Bureau has worked very hard on dealing with the matter. In the past few years, the administration tries to resolve the problem, but some members like Dr. Fernando Chang insist on fundamental humane principles, everything can be set aside, including public interests of can be set aside. Are we not humane? You look at the United States. Donald Trump is going to build a big wall to prevent illegal immigrants from coming. Now, some suggest closed camps, but the government has not sent the claimants to closed camps. The claimants have personal freedom while they're waiting for the screening, and there is legal aid given to the claimants so that they can defend themselves. At the same time, we cannot ignore public interests. There are claimants who abuse the system. This is a humane policy. They stay in Hong Kong illegally. While they are staying in Hong Kong, they try to make money. That exists. I want to ask the Secretary, with regard to extending the 2 supernumerary posts, the terms of or the list of duties of the AD has been provided, but the claimants, they gang up together, they engage in fights, they do illegal work, and these are the problems. But I have not seen in the paper that the AD of the Immigration Department does cover cracking down on illegal working by the claimants. Are there any ways to address the concerns that are close to the heart of the people? The Undersecretary, thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chang, for supporting our proposal. As for Mr. Chang's concern with regard to the claimants suspected to be involved in some offences, Mr. Lee earlier on has already spoken on that. Under the OSCB, there is a dedicated team to follow up on such offences and take effective measures. As for working illegally, the Immigration Department has spared no efforts in cracking down on illegal working. Starting from 2010 to 2014, the number of arrests of NECII working illegally were in the level of 100 or so. In 2017, the number increased to 381 cases. So the Immigration Department has stepped up its efforts in cracking down on working illegally by the claimants. And the Immigration Department will not relax in this regard. Ms. Claudia Mo, Ms. Priscilla Leung said that the administration has to make sure that the system should not be abused. We do not welcome the claimants with open arms. The government tried to prevent them from coming, so there is no abuse. I think the approach is to prevent them from coming. Now, concerning the routing, they come via China. How can you explain the situation? Are there any breakdowns? Are they mainly from India and Pakistan? Do you agree that you just judge them before trial? As long as they have arrived, your target is to send them back, and you just believe that they come for economic reasons and nothing else. Is there such an attitude? Thank you, Ms. Mo. Thank you, Chairman. I can show you some numbers for reference. With regard to the claimant procedures from 2016 until now, at that time there was a substantial increase, and we asked the mainland public security units to assist us in stopping the IIs. Through the work with the mainland PSB, five PSB authorities, and also many mainland officers help us in preventing the IIs from coming. From February 2016 until now, mainland authorities have tracked down on 67,000 IIs, and they also detected 53 organized groups of II traffickers. As for the number of cases attempting to coming to Hong Kong, 293 cases, and the number of NEC IIs, 3,400. Without mainland public security authorities assistance stopping the IIs from the north, the challenge would have been even bigger. We should not let down our guards in terms of preventing the IIs from coming. The Immigration Department and the two other disciplined forces have taken joint operations and arrested 410 persons. We should not relax our guard. But do you have some preconceived assessment of these people? Of course not. We deal with their cases fairly and squarely. Mr. Leung Chi Chiang, the two supernumerary posts should be extended from the peak of more than 10,000 cases. The number has been reduced to 1,000 or so. That's very substantial. And the two posts have played a very important part in that. I support the proposal. And so 6,000 cases. It's difficult to deal with them completely by this approach. The number of true or real refugees is just 1,000 or so. So most of them are not true refugees or genuine refugees. Now, Ms. Au Nok Hin asked a question concerning the provision of information and the form. Is ours more complicated, so that even the screening is made more difficult? Can you simplify your process? And also for closed camps, it is not humane But if it is a kind of open center, so that those claimants who are waiting for screening can be contacted by officers of various government departments and also social workers, so that they will not go out to work illegally and they will not commit crimes. Why can't the administration consider this?
Undersecretary, okay, thank you, Mr. Leung. So Mr. Leung is broadly correct. So after our screening, lower than 1% claims were substantiated. In the past, the immigration have handled over 14,000 cases, and only about 117 cases successful. So, which are roughly in line with the countries near west, like South Korea and Taiwan. In these forms, we hope to give the claimants and to lay down the grounds and their personal particulars and background. That is to ensure that the applicants are able to set out their case to facilitate our processing. There's also, as well as to ensuring their rights. As for the open camps, so I just respond to Dr. Leung. We have looked into various options, and under however there are considerations therein that we haven't dropped that idea yet. In early next year, an amendment bill before we table that to let go, we plan to present our thoughts to the panel. Mr. Chen Kinpo, I support this manpower proposal. Even though we have achieved some very good results, and if not that you have implemented this a year or two, you would only attract more and more people now that we have a lot, few cases. However, and to ensure not to rebound or make it worse than before, you should keep up adding more manpower. And the department will be in the best position to know how many people to add, so I totally support this. Any other question to follow up? I just wanted to express yourself. Mr. Jimin, as we know that since 2015, according to police figures, to 2017, the number of NACIIs breaking the law, the 40% increase, but 1,542 people, and after setting those two separate NIM reposts, we have to conduct early processing. The 25 weeks processing time is now reduced to 10 weeks in 2017. I wanted decided cases over 4,000 cases, an 80% rise in the first 9 months of 2018. And the Immigration Department had decided on over 4,000 cases, a 30% increase year on year. And the immigration predicted that by early 2019, able to clear the backlog of cases. Well, you can see the average set of these two supernumerary posts to be very effective in dealing with these non-reforming claimants. So, of course, I would support the extension of these two posts, but what if without these two positions, that you're not able to meet the target by 2019? And besides adding these two positions, would the immigration require more manpower to deal with this kind of claims? Undersecretary, thank you, Mr. Ng, for supporting our manpower proposal. And Jim and Ms. Ng are very knowledgeable on this. And the immigration department, there are still 17 cases yet to be screened. Like Mr. Ng said, there has been improvement. In future, we will move our manpower downstream. So there's still 6,500 cases pending appeal, and some of them are waiting to be removed. And these are very complicated with lots of factors for consideration. And not that immigration department has a much smaller workload, and consider the work has to be done. There's still a lot of work is ahead. For example, the downstream appeal cases, how do we do with the TCAB's work, and the Assistant Director of Immigration, we need a strong coordination and strategic skill, especially where repatriation is concerned. There was no direct flight relation with the countries of origin, and the coordination with our consular offices and the issuance of travel documents that we need to discuss with these countries. It was quite challenging. Mr. Tony Chair, and for the non-reforming claimants, and those are substantiated after processing was only like 0.8%, and some cite this is a bogus refugee issues. What is to our livelihood? A law and order. Well, some may see this as posing serious challenges. So I support the Bureau's review to shorten the processing time. And at the you can see the results from the numbers. Therefore, I will support extending this supernumerary post. So, is 3 years enough? Well, from the figures I got, those who are pending appeal, there were 6,500 cases, and some of them cases yet to be screened. There's about 8,000 or. I wonder if my numbers are correct. So after being rejected, they can still lodge an appeal. Can they also resort to judicial review when the appeal failed? Though that will take a lot of manpower and time. So can 3 years enough to make it manageable? I have some reservations of skepticism. I wonder, have this SB have performed any assessment? Thanks for Mr. Chair's support. So we being practical, making this proposal with it. So for the first 3 years, we have seen results. We anticipated a lot of challenges ahead. With this, we come to this panel to get this panel blessing to get a further extension for 3 years. We're closely monitoring how things unfold. We must remember, however, on a few areas, especially on the interception and also on processing and what is our progress, and thirdly, on appeal, and fourthly, on the removal. And Mr. Chair mentioned, and for those waiting appeal, there were over 6,000 cases. Besides waiting pending appeal, there are 1,700 cases waiting to be screened. And some of the cases arranging repatriation is about 1,600. And some, due to other reasons, well, maybe they broke the law and are serving a sentence and waiting some other kind of processing. So there are 14,000 people in total. So we can see we still have challenges we need to deal with it carefully. While making this request of 3 years, that we have been acting prudently and hope that we get the support of this panel. Last person, Mr. Junius, Dr. Junius Ho. I support the extension of this to supernumerary post. Two reminders here from the 2014 to 19, and for the 15,000 non-reforming torture claimants. Well, within this 5 years, we will spend a total of $4.8 billion, about $1.4 billion on administration, $700 million on legal assistance, and $2.7 billion on the living expenses. To create these two posts, there are time limited, not indefinite. I hope for the early resolution of this torture claimants on issue. And some of the words I heard are misleading the public. We're not opening up our doors to any illegal immigrants. we need to differentiate between genuine refugees or torture claimants. In the past, the numbers provided by the SB and what they 1,400 as 480, and 97 cases have been approved, and our take-up rate at 100%. And those 11,300 odd people, these are bogus. These are illegal immigrants. And would Claudio Mo open the door to let anyone in to take their bed? You have to, at least you want to ask the name and who are they looking for. So we have our borders to protect. Dr. Philip Chung said that we have to be nicer to them. We have to be very nice to them. Are you willing to donate your salary to donate to those street sleepers in some shape? Please walk the talk. We need to look at numbers and the actual circumstances to act. And over 13,000 cases had already been given allowance and returned home. And about 70%, my second warning is that. So how long would the appeal take? While you, it's all right to add more manpower. So what's the bottleneck? That's the judicial review. So you finish off the administrative appeal, they will resort to JR. Can you ask the judiciary that how many administrative judges are there to handle this kind of JR? Please don't drag on for too long. If there are 70 cases, about 6,000 or 7,000 cases, it would take more than 2 to 3 years to complete. If you don't have good communication with judiciary, I will not grant for the extension, but I will allow you this time. Any response from Secretary? I'll respond briefly. First, I would like to thank Dr. Ho for his support. I would, for Dr. Ho's information, screening mechanism to meet the high degree of fairness set down by the court. And under this frame says the substantiated cases of the below 1%, well, actually 0.8%. And Mr. Ho, claim that they will stay in Hong Kong, which is incorrect. After substantiated, they'll be referred to the UN Agency for Refugees to let them consider resettling in other countries. Ms. Mo, what's your question? He's just smearing me. I said very clearly, it's exactly because Hong Kong is not open their arms to welcome them. We don't have such system in place. And yet you said that, that's what you said, we have to open our arms. Okay, we got your point, Ms. Mo. Do your colleagues, after I draw the line, there's still one member who would like to speak, and some member requests for the second round. Because we are on very tight time frame, their request will be declined. So we've heard 12 members have spoken, about 9 of which have expressed their support. One of them expressly objected. I think the panel in principle and not object the SB to forwarding manpower proposal to ESD. There are 2 members who express objections. If you'd like to follow up, you can discuss that in the ESC. Thank you, Undersecretary. Item number 5. Briefing by the Commissioner of the ICAC on the 2018 policy address. Can we invite the Commissioner and his team in? Members, may I remind you that our meeting is supposed to finish by 11. If we don't object, we extend by 15 minutes so that everyone will get more time for questioning.
Well, we have Mr. Pei, the commissioner, and also Mr. Yao, head of operations, Ms. Rita Liao, director of corruption prevention, and Mr. Ho, director of community relations. The commissioner, if you have settled down, would you please give us a briefing on the policy address? And those who want to ask questions, please press button. Chairman members, I will speak on the major outline of the report. In 2017, the corruption, 2018, the corruption scene, in the first 9 months, we received non-election related complaints, 2,042, an increase in comparison, same period 2017, a decline of 8%, pursuable complaints, 1,571. A decline of 8% in comparison same period. Corruption, the distribution is 67 for private sector, 26 for government department, 7% for public bodies. According to information collected, corruption is under control. Overall situation is satisfactory. The support given to the ICAC is still high by the public. In the latest survey, 97% of the respondents support the work of ICAC, and 35% of the complainants are willing to give their name to make a complaint. And this has shown the confidence in the professional law enforcement of the ICAC. In the first 9 months, 109 persons in 69 cases were prosecuted for non-election offenses, a decline of 13%, and the number of cases increased by 5%. As for the division between public sector and private sector, you can refer to my work report. Let me now turn to the major initiatives of the ICAC. In law enforcement, we will uphold fairness and disregard the background and status of the person. We will pursue each and every case. Now, with the launching of Operation Building Bright 2.0 and also the FSIW subsidy scheme, there may be more complaints in terms of building renovation. We will have a dedicated team to handle suspected bid rigging complaints. And we will also continue to combat the corruption cases of listed companies who work with government departments and share intelligence and take joint enforcement action to strengthen Hong Kong's status as an international commercial and financial center to ensure that the September by-election in 2018 and 2019 rural election are done without corruption, together with the EAC and the HAB and the police. We will work together and exchange intelligence, review the instructions and the law in order to prevent any corruption election. As for cases involving lump sums, large sums of money, we will look into the various issues and provide anti-corruption suggestions. Two-thirds of the complaints involves private sector. The ICAC will devote more resources on prevention of corruption in private sector, targeting in specific industries and trades, and take initiative to make suggestions and advice in the cross public private sector approach. We'll work with the public bodies and the government departments to deal with public works to prevent corruption, in particular in terms of integrity management system, control systems, inside supervision, and management subcontractors. As for OBB 2.0 and also FSIW subsidy scheme, we will work with the URA and to incorporate corruption prevention measures in administration of the funding schemes. We also organize briefings for building owners and contractors. We also formulate measures to prevent corruption. We'll work with the professional bodies and also our Hong Kong EX to help listed companies to enhance the anti-corruption measures and also enhance their disclosure. In terms of education, we'll continue to provide integrity training to public officers and civil servants. We provide internet teaching materials and training materials to explain and enhance their awareness towards misconduct in public office. We also work with the insurance industry to upgrade integrity management. There will be a two-year reading for integrity project comprising production picture books and organizing of reading club activities, training for educators, and large-scale reading gala targeting at the students and parents and teachers. We will also launch a multimedia youth for youth cooperation project engaging young people to develop positive core value of integrity, enhance positive engagement of young people on various media platforms so as to reinforce their core values of integrity. The by-election of Kowloon West Geographical Constituency and the rural election in 2017, there will be a number of publicity efforts to promote fair election and integrity. As for international cooperation, we'll work with other anti-corruption agencies, in particular those who have closer trade relations with Hong Kong, including the ASEAN countries and also the Belt Road countries. We'll provide assistance in terms of training to enhance the anti-corruption efforts. We are now working very closely with 13 countries. Last year, I went to Croatia to participate in an anti-corruption conference and met with the heads of anti-corruption authorities of over a dozen countries, and they have very strong interest in cooperating with the ICAC. We believe that working with other anti-corruption agencies will help the promotion of anti-corruption, enhance our status as implementing the Anti-Corruption Convention of the UN, and we send a clear message to the international community that we are determined to fight corruption. Next year, May, the Commission, together with World Justice Projects, will host the International Conference, the 7th ICAC Symposium in Hong Kong. The theme is Fighting Corruption, A New Perspective. It provides a platform for anti-corruption experts and related professionals from different jurisdictions to share their experience, initiatives, and strategies in combating corruption. After the meeting, we will work with the UN CAC state members to provide training. The ICAC will continue to work with the community to adopt a three-pronged approach to fight corruption and promote integrity. And through various channels, we will work with the community and brief and inform the community on our efforts and outcome of promoting or fighting corruption, and also our advantages. Thank you. The speaking notes of the Commissioner has been distributed to members. Because of time constraint, each member is only given 3 minutes, and I have to draw a line there. Seven have asked to speak. First, Mr. Chen Chenying. First, I am also a member of a committee of two committees under the ICAC. Paragraph 4 says that the administration in implementing the projects may jeopardize public safety. An example is the MTRC. I think one very important thing is the whistleblower. Many who report my report corruption cases. They may not be able to make use of email because they are just ordinary workers. In terms of promoting anti-corruption, do you have any positive ways to encourage reporting within the system? The Commission also refers to OBB 2.0 and also FSIW subsidy scheme, and this may lead to some corruption activities. And there is also the lift and escalators, the lift maintenance or improvement financing scheme. Are there any? Will you take into account this lift renovation subsidy into your anti-corruption efforts? First, on reporting, we encourage reporting in different ways. One can report personally or by email. The simple way is to make a telephone call, and our number is 266-366. Everybody knows that. It's been there for decades. And you also can write to the ICAC. We would like to facilitate the reporting by every means. As for the lift renovation scheme, subsidy scheme, I ask Ms. Liu to supplement. Now, when there is a subsidy scheme involving large sums of public money, say maintenance of buildings, lifts, involving public safety, in a very early stage, we work with the departments to concern to understand, or bureaus concerned to understand the details, and then we give our input in a very early stage. After that, we will continue to work with the bureaus and departments. We also assist the owners corporations in prevention of corruption. As for lift safety, we have worked with the various bureaus. We are looking at the draft of the blueprints, and we have given our input. As for the future procedures, the application and supervision, we will continue to work with the body that are responsible for the execution of the program. Ms. Alohin, paragraph 14 says that the ICAC work with public bodies and government departments to enhance public works contractors' corruption prevention awareness and capabilities. Now, the most notorious case is the MTR case. Now, there is exchange of information with ICAC in respect of the cutting of steel bars. We cannot comment on the individual cases, but can you tell us, with regard to such a big concern, you say there will be improvements. Will you review the mechanism? And will there be specific measures to deal with these large-scale infrastructure projects? In 1999, the ICAC conducted a study on the construction industry, and after 20 years, it is no longer updated. So will you conduct another study? The Commissioner. As of course, we cannot comment on individual cases. Prevention is always better than cure. With regard to large-scale projects and also the construction industry, I ask Ms. Liu to speak on that. As for public body projects and public projects, efficiency, safety, reliability requires the participation of stakeholders. Supervision by government departments and public bodies are important. the integrity and capability of the contractors, integrity management, and professional skills are also very important.
And the in the corruption prevention department, is not especially in the wake of the recent incidents. And all along, whenever there are new engineering contracts or major public works in the preparation phase, whether for the tender evaluation and the drafting of tender documents, we already provide anti-corruption input. For example, in the tender document, they were at the integrity clauses and anti-bid rigging provisions. And in our work, they will step up our collaboration with the works department on how to review the works department supervision of the contractor's management handbook. And the works bureau, the development bureau, is also reviewing the engineering consultant mechanism. And at different time, and on the public works by different works department will provide careful reporting. And for the integrity management of main contractor and subcontractors, and very soon, on the contractor handbook, that we will serve a service to the those listed on the contractor's handbook. For example, the integrity management, and some is staff reporting and illegal behavior, and on the management of subcontractor. And the site supervision and materials control, and we shall liaise with the relevant institute to step up training so that the frontline staff or those and engineers and architect and the surveyors can play their respective role. And to assure the integrity management. And from time to time, on the government's management regime, especially the works management, and we would exchange views and provide anti-corruption advice. Ms. Claudia Mo, a lot of the Hong Kong people would still believe that ICAC is a Hong Kong's competitive edge. Of course, you won't comment on any cases, as some of the cases are very well known, were under ICAC investigation. Not only the allow of public concern, as well as of a matter of great public interest. For example, someone receiving $50 million and failing to declare. Are you worried that your investigation carried on a snail pace, or simply go with the motions, you're simply undermining the ICAC's reputation? I'll defer to Mr. Yao, the head of operations. And Ms. Claudia Mo and McClear, that would not comment on specific cases. And how much time or the investigation will take depends on the complexity. And ICAC has been acting in accordance with the law, and we also have a wholesome mechanism. And if necessary, we will seek legal advice. And on the report to the Corruption Reporting Committee to ensure each case will get a sufficient investigation. Well, there are some will give you the impression that you seem to be procrastinating till the end of time. That look very bad in the eyes of the public. I have nothing to supplement. Well, we deal with each case in an impartial manner. As for the procedure and the time will take, we not comment. Any follow-up question, Ms. Mo? And on the election fraud, while this is a serious issue, some of them are very minor breaches. For example, a 10-dollar difference in your election declaration. The ICAC actually sent to investigation officer to my office to find out where did the $10 got to. It's simply a waste of resources. Well, would you investigate only for a bigger account, let's say only a difference of $1,000? Well, I even experienced a difference of a few cents. This is really a waste of resources and time. You can just ask us to apologize instead of sending two officers, Mr. Rikiao. According to electoral legislation, it had defined the breaches. So whenever the ICAC received a public complaint or the EAC referring cases to us, the ICAC had a statutory duty to deal with them. And we also had a summary procedure dealing with these complaints. And in the process, we can see some of them are rather minor. And we continuous review that, and also liaise with the relevant policy bureau and the EAC. And we're actually looking into the breaches in the ceiling of election expenditure to be revised so that we don't have to spend a lot of resources and deal with such minor cases. Would that be $1,000, the ceiling? Mr. Tony Che. Mr. Chen Chenjing and I would share the concern how the construction industry can prevent corruption. I heard that the commissioner and talk about how the building up safety scheme and the operation building board have initiatives in place. So I'm glad to see that when the government launched new initiatives, the ICAC would liaise them before and providing some guidelines. And for the $2.5 billion lift modernization program, I believe we had to be very careful because this is a very closed shop with very tight manpower, so there's with a higher likelihood of bid rigging. I hope that your department can look into it. And you have had a lot of guidelines and best practices. I wonder if ICAC regularly review with other departments on the effectiveness. So the theory is one thing, there might be problem with the actual implementation. And have you consulted the industry professionals of any operational issues or any loopholes? I wonder, had the ICE Commission look into it? And on the lift and modernization program that would assist the government department and the bureau to make sure it do a proper job. As for we also have a regular review. We have stepped up liaison with different industries. And for the government department, especially the public works, the review will be on integrity management and corruption prevention. And for the efficiency or the policy suitability, they're probably not the scope of our review. And of course, if we can enhance the transparency and the supervision, and also able to streamline the measures that were simply in line with the principles of corruption prevention. Well, maybe you can consult the relevant professional institutes. Well, working with a few professional institutes, for example, surveyors, architects, and so on, we had a dialogue. And as for the site construction and the building materials management and frontline supervision, we have noted the views from the sector, and is a right juncture. We will relate the sector's views to the relevant bureau and the departments. To hope that we can be in pace with the times. We have three members have the question. Do you mind waiting for another 15 minutes, Dr. Valencia? First, we're very supportive of ICAC's work, and I would comment on this commission's work. And also an important pillar in maintaining integrity and probity in our society. I hope the ICAC can continue to stay impartial and give fair treatment to all cases. Well, the authoritarian rule is tightening its grip. And for those with power and status, when we suspect of abusing the power on important cases, if ICAC appears to be weak and powerless, and that will create a negative public perception. Well, there are a lot of infrastructure projects happening over the past decade. Well, for the public works and the other projects will give rise to a lot of corruption and non-compliance. Well, since it involved a huge amount of money in the hundreds of millions, well, these are the hotbed for corruption. I know that you have also the guidelines and such. Would you proactively conduct investigation? Where that you pick up some tiny clues that you should intervene in time. Well, for the dollar and cents differences, why you decide to be so thorough? Well, sometimes I feel that you have too much manpower. Well, for these kind of matters, you are so hot on your heels. Well, ICAC told me they would like to talk to me on the election issues. That maybe they complain. On the Dr. Fernando Chung's day was the subject of complaint. I wonder, what does it have to do with corruption? On election fraud. I think you have to set your priorities straight and be decisive on major cases and to conduct more proactive investigation. Thank you for Dr. Chung's support. The big opening speech, we have been acting impartial without fear or favor, regardless of their background and the status and the position of the papers, that they would track down all the corruption cases. This has been the position of the ICAC. As for the time it takes for case investigation, dependent complexity, the procedures, and so on, the ICAC would not drag on his feet. That I want to make it clear. And for each cases, we'll put our best effort, whether it's a big case or minor differences in election expenditure declaration will give it equal treatment in accessing due diligence. As for the construction industry and infrastructure, as cited by Dr. Cheung and Ms. Liao has already spoken at length. And for the corrective investigation, I'll hand over to Mr. Ricky Yao.
Thank you, Chairman. The ICC takes a proactive approach depending on circumstances. We conduct criminal investigation, and this is based on evidence. That's very important. Ms. Priscilla Leung. I also want to follow up on the nature of work of the ICAC and its manpower. I appreciate the decades of works of the ICAC and the image of rule of law has the contribution from the ICAC. I've been following this issue for several years, and I've followed some specific cases. In terms of election-related cases, you only combat the small fries. I think the situation is across the party line. Your role is to combat corruption. Everybody supports that. But in terms of election, for a decade, I say this is a non-election ordinance rather than election or electoral ordinance. This is a loophole for those inexperienced. Just a single word, independent. It will become the tool for making political attacks. And you spend a lot of manpower to conduct investigation. Do you have excess manpower to deal with very small issues? Now, this case was closed. Now, that is a consent to give support. Everybody gives a consent to support, but that is a statutory form, and the form was given later. There was late, and there was prosecution. And a district councillor spent over millions of dollars. Well, that's your work. Can you be more serious in consider our suggestion? Should the law be changed? It should not be for the ICAC to investigate administrative matters under the EAC. You should not waste your resources. It is just a misadministration or administrative mistake, and then just a few hundred dollars exceeding the limit, then it falls on your lap. There's a problem with the electoral law. They shouldn't put everything under the ICAC. The ICAC should look at more high-level matters. The commissioner, will you make a serious suggestion to the government to amend the electoral ordinance? The candidates are angry. District councillors, legislative councillors are furious. They have experienced such harassment of these small details. With regard to the election illegal and malpractices ordinance, we are the law enforcement body. And we need to enforce the law. It's not that we have excess manpower. We do our best, do our level best. We spend no effort in conducting investigation in every case. Our colleagues are working very hard. As for your view on the electoral ordinance, I will refer your view to election ordinance. We'll refer your view to the Relevant Bureau. There is no, well, your point is clear. Last one, Mr. Ma Fong Kwok. Well, Chairman, concerning the work of the ICAC, I support the ICAC, and I should commend the ICAC, but concerning the report, Now, the report refers to international cooperation. A very important aspect has not been mentioned, and that is anti-corruption in respect of the mainland, in say, a cooperation with the mainland in fighting corruption. Now, corruption may have occurred in the mainland, but the transfer of money may involve Hong Kong. What has been done by the ICAC in this regard? And what is the performance in cooperating with the mainland authorities? Now, in the NPC Congress in March, there was a piece of law passed. There is a supervisory commission. The discipline review committee has a joint platform in conducting in dealing with corruption matters. Is there any arrangements working relation with the mainland authorities in fighting corruption? The Commissioner, thank you, Mr. Mao, for the question. With regard to cooperation with the mainland, we started our cooperation 30 years ago in investigating cases. And throughout the 30 odd years, the mechanism has been operating very smoothly. And our counterpart is the Supreme People's Procuratorate Anti-Corruption Office. With the setting up of the Supervisory Commission, there is a change in mechanism in May. In Beijing, I met with the National Supervision Commission, Mr. Yang, the chief of the commission, and I had meetings with the various officials, and we established a new counterparty relation. We are now working on a memorandum of cooperation, and within the near future, it will be completed and will be signed. To put it simply, there are over 30 years of cooperation, and we are on good terms. I hope that in the future, in similar reports, there will be some coverage as to how we cooperate with our country in fighting corruption. Can that be done? Yes, certainly. All right, so much for this item. We now come to agenda item number 6, AOB. There is nothing under AOB, so the meeting is now adjourned. Thank you very much.